take this one in case, maybe you can use it. You think I can put that one there in case, just for emergency?
Yep. Okay.
Yeah, just for in case.
Just in case, yeah.
No, that's... Sorry about that.
No, it's fine.
Yes.
Good morning. Very glad to see you all here this morning. You might notice I'm a little lonely up here due to some illnesses that have popped up and some people that have been returned to their home countries as such. But very excited to have you here and very excited to hopefully hear you all worship with me. So I'm going to invite you to stand if you're able to. And join me, and I hope you came prepared to worship. And if you didn't, if you can just take a breath right now, and we'll start singing. This song is kind of a call and response song. I think your parts are mostly in the brackets there, so.
With all of my heart, and I will praise you with all of my strength. I will seek you all of my days, and I will follow all of your ways.
Okay, we're gonna do that again because I need to hear a little bit more voices, and but I think you got the hang of it. Okay.
I will worship with all of my heart, and I will praise you with all of my strength. I will seek you all of my days, and I will follow all of your ways, and I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise.
All right, I will bow down.
I will bow down. Hail you as King. And I will serve you. Give you everything. I will lift up my eyes to your throne, and I will trust you. I will trust you alone, and I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise. I will give you all my worship. I will give you all my praise. You alone I long to worship. You alone are worthy of my praise.
All right, amen. You can take a seat.
Today's service is a blessing to each and every one who has joined with us here today. Let's open in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this Sunday morning and the opportunity in a free country, in a country that is at peace, in a country that we must not forget is very prosperous in this world, the opportunity to come together and to acknowledge that you are the master of all of these things. We pray, Father, that you will be with each and every person here today. Put your hand upon them and let this service be a blessing to them. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Where is she hiding? Emily Defer, come on up. Katie, I'm going to let Katie go first. You can introduce your Katie and do your trick.
So I don't know if everyone had the chance, hopefully everyone did, to meet Emily. Can you hear me? Oh, can you hear me now? So this is Emily. Emily's been working with us in the children's department in Sunday school, and she also worked in Awana. She's been here for the past couple years, let's say. She was at Queen's University finishing up her degree, and I have to tell you, Emily's just been such a blessing here. I'm going to be so sad to see her go. But at the same time, I am so excited because I just know she is going to do amazing things. I know that God's going to work through her, and she's going to be a blessing to other people where she lands. And hopefully she'll be back to visit us anyhow. You better. So I just wanted to present her with just this little devotional, just to take with her, to remember us, and to just let her know how much we're grateful to have had her, and that we'll be praying for her.
Don't run away. I've got something to say, too. Emily has also, every Tuesday night, been very diligent in coming to Awana and working with our children and our children's ministry. And as she goes back to Ottawa, we're down a worker. We know that she would be a blessing wherever she goes. And we want to thank her very much for all of her loyal service at Awana. Thank you, Emily. A few announcements. Number one, there's a mission opportunity later this month at Chinese Alliance. Stand by for more information. We have had very little fellowship with Chinese Alliance. And I think that this is going to be an amazing opportunity for us to go and get to know that church and for them to get to know ours. And I know it's going to be a blessing. All the King's Men is a group of Kingston evangelical men who get together once in a while for a great men's breakfast. On the 20th of April, there will be this time of fellowship together, a breakfast. And the speaker you may recognize, it's Pastor Marcus. Again, that'll be at Bay Park Baptist Church. The next Evergreen for our 55-plus seniors will be held on May 1st. Please come and please invite other 55-plus seniors, friends, family that you have in Kingston. Don't hesitate to bring them out to this lunch that we do once a month, the first Wednesday of the month. And finally, the pastor will be running another membership seminar on the 5th of May. Membership seminar on the 5th of May after the church service. Ladies and gentlemen, the government of Canada tells us that the average life expectancy in Canada is about 80 years of age. I would like everyone to stand up this morning, except for those who are not able. Please stand up. Look around, and that's a good chunk of our church, okay, is here with us this morning. I'd like everybody over 70 to sit down. That's our church. What you see now is that's our church in 60 years' time. Everyone over 60, sit down. That's our church. I'm sorry, that's going to be our church in 50 years' time. Everyone over 50, sit down. That's going to be our church in 30 years' time. Everyone over 40, sit down. That's going to be our church in about 20 years. Everyone over 30, sit down. That's going to be our church in 20 years. Everyone over 20, sit down. Their church will close. That's the reality. That is the reality. Is that our churches are aging, and if we are going to survive as a church amongst a community of churches, We've got to go out beyond these walls. These walls are not a fortress to keep us in. These walls protect a base of operations, as we say in the military, to go out and to launch offensive operations into our community. We have to reach out to people with a message of salvation through Jesus Christ. That's our message. And we have to help people and bring people into our church to grow the community of believers. If the church cannot do that, the church, this church at least, will not survive. We have a wide range of ministries, and we're going to grow those ministries over the next year or two to reach out into our community. One of the most critical ministries is a ministry to children, the junior church. While adults are up here getting fed the word at the adult level, down below, the children are being fed at a children's level. And on Tuesday night, the Awana ministry brings kids from this church, from other churches, and from unchurched kids into our church and plants the word of Christ. For over 50 years, Awana has been the children's ministry of this church. The Bible tells us in Proverbs 22:6, start children off on the way they should go, and even when they are old, they will not turn from it. This fall, our Awana ministry will be in crisis. It will be in a crisis situation due to a lack of leaders. Through death, through retirement, through health issues, other commitments, several of our leaders have or will retire this year. And as they do, they need to be replaced. I urge every one of you who has a passion for children, I urge every one of you to speak to Gail Pritchard. Gail, stand up. Wave your arms above your head. That's Gail. And Marge Beardsley at the back, come on up. Wave your hands above your head. If you are called, and I'd ask you to prayerfully consider this request, if you are led, please speak to one of them about how you could get involved in the Awana ministry. I'd also like to acknowledge the service, long-term service of Laura Miller, who this year has retired from Awana. Laura took over from Jack's previous wife. When Jack's wife died, she married Jack, and then she took over, and she became a faithful Awana teacher, and this year she has retired. So we want to thank her for her service. Thank you very much, Bob.
All right, well, I'll invite you to stand and join me again if you're able, and we'll continue our time of worship.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. For he is good, he is above all things. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, his love endures forever. And for the life that's been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. Forever God is with us, forever, forever. From the rising to the setting sun, his love endures forever. And by the grace of God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever,
forever you are.
Forever you are faithful. Forever you are strong. Forever you are with us. Forever and ever. Forever. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean, singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows, and he made them his very own. And he bore the burden to Calvary, and suffered and died alone. Singing how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. And with the ransomed in glory, his face I at last shall see. It will be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. And we'll sing how marvelous, how wonderful, in my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love. For how marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be.
I worship you. So let it be on you.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here, touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, healing every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here, bending every heart. I worship you. Stop working, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop, say that again. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop. 'Cause you are the way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. You are the waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
That is who.
That is who you are. That is. mercy.
Thanks, Matt. And let's just come to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity to come together and to worship you. And we thank you that, again, that we live in a country that allows us to do that freely. And we just pray that that will never be lost on us. And we pray for of those countries where there's conflicts, where they may not be able to worship freely, and those places where, again, there's conflict in the world. We think of Israel, we think of Ukraine, but so many other places as well. We just pray for world leaders that are involved in those conflicts, that they will lean on you, and that they will that you will grant them wisdom, and that these conflicts can be resolved soon and peacefully. We thank you again for our church. We thank you for our volunteers, and we think of Emily and Laura, who have served faithfully in our children's ministries, and for them moving on in the next chapter of their life. We just pray your blessings on them. And we pray for that you will lay on the hearts of people who are perhaps in this congregation right now, that they can move into the next chapter of their lives and to take on a ministry with our children, which is so important for the future of our church, and to reach out to our community. So we just pray that you will lay that on their hearts. And not only for children's ministries, but our other ministries, such as a storehouse, sound, and evergreen. And we just pray that, again, that you will raise up people for that. We pray for those that aren't able to attend today. We just pray that you will comfort them physically and spiritually, and that you will minister to them. Either online or in some other fashion, we just pray that you will bless them in the situation that they're in. And we thank you for the growth we're experiencing at Kingston Alliance Church, and we pray for continued growth in our attendance and conversions and baptisms and membership, and we thank you for what we've seen over the last year. We just pray for that to continue. And we pray that Kingston Alliance Church will become an even brighter light to our surrounding Kingston community and for continued support to ministries abroad. And we pray for our international workers. We think of David Smith in particular, the Pianerosas. We think of our global advanced international workers in promoting the gospel worldwide, sometimes in dangerous situations. We just pray your protection on them and the blessings on them, and that we will support all of them in our prayers and also in our tithes and offerings. We pray for Marcus in his travels to just keep him safe, and we pray for the All the King's Men event coming up on Saturday where Marcus will be speaking. We just pray your blessings on that event and on Marcus as he delivers his message there. And again, we just praise you for the generous contributions from our congregation towards our ministry here and the physical needs of our church. And we thank you for last week's general meeting and for the unity that was shown there. And we just thank you for Greg Roberts, who is with us this morning, who's ministering to us on behalf of the Africa Inland Mission. Just bless him as he delivers his message, as we are blessed by those words. We just pray your Holy Spirit will be over us all. And this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, the children, I think up to ages 14, are free to go downstairs. And with that, We'll move on to our video.
Well, it is a privilege to be here with you this morning. It is, you're not I haven't been here in a little bit in this role, but you're reasonably familiar to me. And I would think that I might be reasonably familiar to some of you as well. As has been mentioned, my name is Greg Roberts, and I'm here today representing Africa Inland Mission, and that's an exciting new development in my life. But I'm also spent 10 and a half years in pastoral ministry at Bay Ridge Alliance, just on the west end of the city. So there's some familiarity here. Not only that, but man, was I ever glad to hear about Awana today, because my family has been a part of the Awana program here at Kingston Alliance pretty much since we moved here. I think there was a bit of shock when my daughter was able to compete in the Grand Prix as a leader, not as a participant, because when she started, she was here, and now she's here. And that's just kind of one of the, yeah, I'm seeing some nodding heads of like, wow, yeah, that did surprise us all, kind of a thing. So there's a long-standing history, and let me back up what Brent said. I have a lot of time for the Awana program, not only just for its impact on my family, but even going back, my wife has a love for the Awana program. She grew up in the Awana program at the church she grew up in Hamilton. And so that is the beauty of programs like that, is we are seeing that passed on from generation to generation. My family is an example of that. And just to see these kids learning the scripture, seeing my kids doing that as they have grown up through that is just tremendous. So I would echo that. As a parent, if you're in a spot to help out with the Awana program, it is wonderful, and I would invite you to do that. But as I mentioned, I'm here with a bit of a different hat on today. In January, I started as the Director of Operations at Africa Inland Mission Canada. And some of you might actually be familiar with AIM. So I actually bring greetings on behalf of our Canadian director, Dr. Dan Bates, who some of you may know. Now, I know some of you may not be familiar with AIM specifically, but I know that this is a church that holds missions in high regard. And I salute you and applaud you for that. Some of that comes as part of our DNA as Alliance churches. You know, it's part of who we are. It's part of what we do. You know, around the world, I know, but it's specifically in Africa. I know you have people serving in North Africa. And not with AIM specifically. AIM does also work in North Africa. And as an organization, we understand the challenges that are involved in working in a place like North Africa. The challenges of bringing the gospel into that area of the world are immense. And so we have an understanding of that very, very strongly, as you do as well. AIM also has a number of people serving in Southern Africa, Eastern Africa, and even now today, our Canadian director, Dr. Dan Bates, as I mentioned, is actually in West Africa with other leaders looking to get a sense of how God is working and calling people to what he is doing in West Africa, specifically within Francophone West Africa, looking for opportunities to partner in bringing the gospel to people who need to hear. As Canadians, we can kind of share in that special burden simply because we have a large Francophone population, and we're kind of praying through and wondering, what does God have in store? How can we mobilize this section of his body to an area that needs to hear about the good news of Jesus Christ? Now, speaking of partnering, I do want to be upfront here that I do want to ask for your support if you're in a position to do so. I certainly mean prayer support. I am in a position to ask for financial support as well. Don't worry, that's not all I'm going to be talking about today. We're going to be getting into the Word. But it's actually important for me to ask these things today kind of because of what I'm going to be talking about. One of the reasons why it's important for me to ask that is because even in my short time with AIM, I have become so impressed by the work the organization does, bringing the gospel to people who otherwise would not hear it, and planting churches in some really unlikely places. There are some really incredible people working with AIM, and I'm privileged to have gotten to know some of them and to get to work with them. The second reason is, and this is kind of what touches on where I want to go this morning, is I believe a big part of how God has made me is to, he has made me to help serve through being part of a structure that enables the work that these incredible people are doing. See, the reality is that there's a lot of administrative legwork, and it kind of gets a bad name, but there's a lot of administrative legwork that goes into getting people on the field and supporting them while they are there. And it's important work. It's necessary work. And I'm thrilled to be a part of a team that does that work. You know, when we talk about some of those things that kind of aren't the more glamorous parts of mission life, you know, and I say that, and I share this with some of our missionaries, they're like, how on earth can people look down on that? We need you guys doing what you are doing so we can do what we do. Here's the thing about why you might not be aware of in all of this is, and the reason why I bring it up is, frankly, it's pretty tough to raise money for this kind of work. And that's because it's tough, right? Even though people see its value, just as I said, the missionaries see the value that the Home Office brings. They're appreciative of the work that the Home Office does and the value that it brings to them and support it gives them. Even though it's not the more glamorous work of the gospel, and hear me right on that, understand mission work is often not glamorous. But it's different when you're hearing about people going out into the field and pioneering missionary work. You know, people are more apt to get behind that. Part of my passion is I've come to realize that I have a passion for seeing Christian organizations be well-run. And I think that's important, to be well-structured. Also, the mission can go forward in what God has called it to do. And so if you're able or interested in supporting Africa Inland Mission, be happy to speak with you. You can also find me on the AIM website as well. Now, as I mentioned, this is not just going to be some level of infomercial for AIM. It's not intended to be that way at all. But it actually dovetails nicely with where I want to take us today. I have very good reason to believe that this is a church that feels strongly about the Great Commission. And I know you are supporters, as I have mentioned, you are supporters of missions throughout Africa. I know the Middle East, as we've prayed for people today, the Global Advance Fund and his Alliance Church, all of those things, I know that you are big supporters of missions and the Great Commission. And I think for all of us as kind of the Western church, church in the Western world, is we can fall into the danger when we look at that, is that the Great Commission is something other people do. And yeah, we send others. You know, that's important to do. But I think it's easy to forget what our role is in all of that. And so that's what we're going to talk about this morning. But before we go any further, I'm just invite you to pray with me before we get into the Word. Lord, we thank you. Again, as has been prayed, that we can gather here together. We recognize that we are in a space where we have the freedom to do so, and we recognize not everyone does, including in places in Africa today. Lord, we may that never be lost on us. But Lord, more than that, when we gather here together, we need to just not sit here for an hour and a bit and go home. We need an encounter with you, and I pray that that would happen in this place. Lord, we thank you for what you've already been doing. Lord, we thank you for all the people who are using their gifts to lead us in worship and look after kids and all the things that are going on here. Lord, we want to see you at work. And Lord, whether that's through what I have to say, Lord, I recognize that folks need to hear from you. And you seem to have chosen me to use that, to be the one to deliver that today. And Lord, if there's anything that's not of you, I'd ask you to move it aside. But Lord, people need to hear from you. And Lord, I pray that we would have an encounter with you. Lord, as we sung, sometimes we forget that if we don't see what you are doing immediately, we think you're not working. Lord, we recognize that even when we don't see it, you are working. Lord, we want to see it. So Lord, I pray that you would show us. Above all, Lord, we pray that we would just meet with you, hear from you, and be blessed by you today as we grow in our knowledge of you. Lord, we ask your blessing upon this time. In your name we pray. Amen. So one of Jesus' most well-known commandments is probably one most of us have heard a lot. And there's a lot of different commandments. You might be thinking of one differently than I am. But so much that it's easy to dismiss it when we come across it because we think, oh, we already know what that is all about. We understand that. We don't really need to delve with it. And we don't need to wrestle with it. And I actually think it is worth looking at and worth wrestling with, even if we think we already understand it, because, you know, especially when we think about this in the context of missions. So I'm actually going to move around a fair amount in terms of our scripture, but the first scripture I want to look at is the Great Commission in Matthew chapter 28. Scriptures, I believe, will be on the screen behind me, so you can feel free to follow along. But the Great Commission at the end of Matthew 28, you know, reads as follows, starting in verse 18. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." You know, I think even as we read this passage that is so familiar to many of us, it's important that we not just remember what the passage is telling us, but remember what it's not telling us. You know, I think, especially if you have a similar history to me, you've grown up and you've heard this passage, and one word kind of sticks out to you in the context of missions. Go! Go! And I think it is a key concept, but somehow we've attached a few modifiers to this statement. Not so much in how we read it. You know, we might have mistakenly thought in how we apply it that somehow only some of us are called to go. And so I think if we look at the Great Commission again, we need to remember that the Great Commission isn't just for some of us. The Great Commission isn't just for some of us. Here's what it doesn't say. It doesn't say some of you need to go. It doesn't say, go if you have time or money. It doesn't say, go if you have nothing better to do. It simply says, go. And if we think about how Jesus leads into this, he says, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to him. Therefore, because of that, he said, go. He's saying, hey, I have the authority here. And incidentally, let me, as a bit of an aside, I think one of the issues facing the church in the Western world today is that we love to talk about God's kingdom, as we should. You know, we pray, your kingdom come, your will be done. We want the kingdom to seep into all the different aspects of our life. We want that. We love the idea of God's kingdom breaking in. But we're not so crazy about having a king. Understand what I'm saying there. We love the kingdom. We're not crazy about having a king. And the reason I say that is because kingdoms, by definition, have kings. And the king is in charge. And here's the hard part for some of us. The king is not you. So when we say we want the kingdom to come, we're automatically saying we want Jesus as the king to come and be in charge. But by definition, that also means we are not. So we can't act like we can be part of God's kingdom without respecting the authority of the king. And so when Jesus claims this authority and says because of this authority that we need to go baptizing, you know, but also teaching them all that he taught them to do, which by also by definition includes what he just tells them, teaching them to do this. I've heard it said, true disciples create more disciples by definition because they are following Jesus' teaching, and Jesus is telling him to go and do just that. It means doing this very thing. I think somehow we have adopted the position that the command to go and make disciples of all nations somehow only applies to some of us. Now, some of you might be wanting to ask a clarifying question. Okay, sure, we're called, but called to go where? And I would bring us to another well-known verse of Scripture, Acts chapter 1, verse 8. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Friends, the reality is we can't all go overseas, because there'd be no one left here. That's not what I'm suggesting. So where are we called to be witnesses? Where are we called to go? Well, let's break this down. You know, Jerusalem. You know, Jerusalem, for these folks that would have been hearing this, that would have represented their local community, their local culture. Okay? It would have been very familiar, which, as some of you may know, is sometimes easier and sometimes harder. You know, we sometimes look at Jerusalem in this context and we think, oh, that would have been the easy part. And yeah, they would have known the language. Yes, they would have understood the culture. Where it's hard is, as some of you may have experienced this, you might be the only believer in your family, and you know that having that conversation in your Jerusalem, your community, is a tough one. Because it's almost too familiar. And it's harder. It's hard in some ways and easy in others. But they're referring to the need to go to their local community. Then he mentions Judea. Judea would have been their region, their local area. And I think there's a few subtle nuances to why this is mentioned here. First of all, I think it implies that the Jerusalem way is not the only way. You know, if you wanted to contextualize that to Ontario, you know, that would be like saying, guess what? We all don't have to do it like Toronto does. To which everyone outside of Toronto agrees. And as someone who spends the bulk of their time in Toronto now, they don't always realize. Okay? But that's kind of one of the things that I think is subtle. But it's also realizing that, hey, you need to look outside your city walls. Because it can be easy to become somewhat insular where it's just like, nope, it's just about our little community here. We're going to keep to ourselves. We're going to make sure we're all okay. We're going to do it our way and everything's going to be fine. But instead, he's saying, no, just look. You know, you got to look beyond the city walls. And I think he's also saying, hey, there might be some subtle cultural differences. You know, there might be some things that you might not be aware of that you have to be thinking about. I actually had to experience that. I think I mentioned at the beginning, I've lived in Kingston for 10 and a half years. And some of you I know who might have grown up in another area. Are there anybody here who grew up in another province? Okay. Well, I knew someone a couple years ago who talked about Ontario culture is like this. And I said, there is no such thing as Ontario culture. And they said, well, there is. And I said, well, no, there's not, because that assumes that everybody's one culture. My experience is I grew up in the Hamilton area, and there are subtle cultural differences between Kingston and Hamilton. Not big ones. We all speak the same language, obviously, you know. But there are subtle cultural differences, and that's okay. But you just have to be aware of it and recognize it, and I think that's what he's calling to. Be aware of that. The third group he mentions is Samaria, also known as the people we don't like. the people we don't like. I think if Jesus had said the Gentiles, that would have actually been less controversial than him saying this. And that's saying something in the culture of that day. You know, we know from the parable of the Good Samaritan that Jews and Samaritans would have had no love lost between them. And so when we think about this in a missions context, these are the folks we have to go, even them? You know, you think about it, situations where I think of World War II after Europe after World War II. There would have been folks who would gladly have sent missionaries to far-off lands rather than the country next door that they'd recently been at war with. That anger was real. And I understand it. But I think Jesus is saying, yeah, even them, even the people you really don't like, need to hear about God's love for them. Even them. Jesus wants them to hear about his good news. And then lastly, the ends of the earth. Literally, everywhere. And so I think if we go back to the birth of the modern missions movement, it makes sense to look to the ends of the earth first. I understand why many did that, including the roots of the Christian Missionary Alliance, looked to that, saying we need to send people to the ends of the earth because they need to hear, and also because there was a sense that Jerusalem and Judea were already Christian. And I think we can debate that, you know, and lots of people have, but I think one thing we can say is that it is obvious that today that the culture that we live here in our Jerusalem is not particularly Christian. It doesn't take more than a look around to determine that. Our Jerusalem needs Christ just as much as the ends of the earth do. So when we look at the where, we need to realize that it isn't Jerusalem or Judea or Samaria or the ends of the earth. It's all of them. Which is why I think we all need to be a part of the going that Jesus commanded us to do. We all need to be a part of that. Now, some of you are going to be concerned about that. You're going to hear that and go, I don't think so. You know, because you might think, I'm not gifted in this way. I'm not a gifted evangelist. I can't do that. So here's the thing. I think we are all called to be a part of the Great Commission as Jesus commanded, but we each have a role to play in it. We each have a role to play in it. Flip over to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Again, this is a well-known passage, but let me read it for us, starting in verse 4. There are different kinds of gifts, but the same Spirit distributes them. There are different kinds of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of working, but in all of them and in every one, it is the same God at work. Now to each one, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for the common good. To one, there is given through the Spirit a message of wisdom. To another, a message of knowledge by means of the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by that one Spirit. To another, miraculous powers. To another, prophecy. To another, distinguishing between spirits. To another, speaking in different kinds of tongues. And still to another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are the work of one and the same Spirit, and he distributes them to each one just as he determines. Just as a body, though one, has many parts, but all of its parts form one body, so it is with Christ. For we were all baptized by one Spirit so as to form one body, whether Jews or Gentiles, slave or free, and we were all given the one Spirit to drink. Even so, the body is not made up of one part, but of many. Now if a foot should say, because I am not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason stop being part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? If the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? But in fact, God has placed the parts in the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. The eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. And the head cannot say to the feet, I don't need you. On the contrary, those parts of the body that seem to be weaker are indispensable. And the parts that we think are less honorable, we treat with special honor. And the parts that are unpresentable are treated with special modesty, while our presentable parts need no special treatment. But God has put the body together, giving greater honor to the parts that lacked it, so that there should be no division in the body, but its parts should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Now you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. And God has placed in the church, first of all, apostles, second, prophets, third, teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healing, of helping, of guidance, of different kinds of tongues. Are all apostles? Are all prophets? Are all teachers? Do all work miracles? Do all have gifts of healing? Do all speak in tongues? Do all interpret? Now eagerly desire the greater gifts.
See, this is an intro. I love that passage. Because, I've got to be honest, we don't do such a great job of it in the church of recognizing all of the gifts and just the value that they all bring. You know, it's an interesting concept to the concept of the Great Commission in many ways, because, yeah, we're called to be a part of the Great Commission, but that doesn't mean we all have the same role to play. It's not designed to be that way, as this passage tells us. Now, hear me right. It's important to not go to extremes, but it's really easy to go to extremes on this particular issue. There will be some who say we all need to be in full evangelist mode, down on the street corner, preaching the word of God all the time. There will be some who say we should never do that, unless, of course, we are gifted and called to do that particular ministry, and they will use this particular verse that we just read as a proof text. And yes, we might operate primarily out of how God has gifted us, but the reality is that the truth likely falls somewhat in between. You know, we can't all do one job, and I think the passage speaks to that. Like, we're not all called to do the same job because it's not practical. It's not how we're made. But also, sometimes we need to do jobs that we're not super interested in or good at. And I want you to think about how a household works, okay? Does anyone have the spiritual gift of washing dishes? Bless you. Bless you, because that would be very popular. I am not passionate about washing dishes. I do not have the spiritual gift of washing dishes. It's not as though that's my spiritual gift, and therefore that's what I do. No one in our house is passionate about washing dishes. My guess is that no one in your house is passionate about washing dishes, except for you. But guess what? As we teach our kids, what happens if no one washes the dishes? Yes, your house is messy. You also run out of dishes. It needs to get done. I am not particularly gifted at cooking. I can handle a barbecue, okay? But there have been times, you know, where all of a sudden that has been thrust upon me. My kids are getting old enough that they can help out a little bit more, and that's nice. You know, but here's the thing about kids. They seem to have this need to be fed. And as the parent, it's my job to do that. Whether or not I'm good at it or not. You know, even though they may say, oh, Dad's cooking, does that mean we're going to Costco again? And you can tell when supper goes south, that's where we end up. I'm not particularly good at it. It needs to get done. We've been told that such things are less important than more spiritual issues. I'm not so sure about that. I don't know anybody that is passionate about cleaning toilets. But I do know people who know the value of a clean and safe and welcoming home, of a clean and safe welcoming store or office building or church building. So they serve through cleaning toilets, washing floors, vacuuming, all sorts of really, really valuable ways, really important ways. And folks, we cannot say to the eye or the hand, I don't need you. Because we do need folks that are doing this. A while back, I had an opportunity to meet a missionary couple from Africa that had just came back from the field, and it was kind of surprising. I have to admit, it did my heart good when I heard it, because they said, "What do you need most on the field?" As they were home for home assignment. You know what their answer was? "We need administrators." I nearly fell out of my chair, quite literally, because I have never heard that. So we needed administrators, because they needed people to come and organize the work that was going on there. There was a lot of really great stuff happening where they were working, but frankly, they needed someone to organize it. They need bookkeepers. They were in an area where there are some resources, not a lot of resources, but things are so disorganized that they don't know where they are. You know, they said one of the sorrows was is that they went into some of these villages, they need people, because they realized they need people to come in after the pioneering missionaries have gone in to disciple people. Pioneering missionaries, they're quite often who we think about when we think about missionaries, people going into new and unreached people groups. 30 years ago, people went in and they went into the village and they preached the word of God and people were saved and it was amazing. And then those people said, "This is great." They were there for a little bit of time and moved on, and nobody came after them. And now they go into these villages 30 years later and going, "I think my parents went to church, but I don't remember much about that." Man, we need people that can follow up on these things. You know, you hear stories from the field that talk about Bible training schools, training local pastors because they don't have the means or the opportunities to go further afield for training, so the training has to come to them. And yes, we need people who can do theological education, and that's really important. But guess what? We also need administrators. We need people to maintain the buildings. We need people to handle the child care where their parents are getting training. All of these sorts of things. We need those people. That's what the people on the field are saying they need. And as I alluded to earlier, one of the main barriers to this actually happening is historically these roles have been difficult to raise support for. Difficult to come up with the resources for. Why? Because it's not thought of as ministry. Folks, it's ministry. I'm here to tell you that those things that these people are doing is ministry. And I have a feeling that there's some folks here that have been told that as well. That what they do isn't ministry. Even if it's being given value, it's kind of knocked down a peg. You see, we're all called into ministry. We all are. Whether that's up here bringing the word on Sunday mornings or cleaning toilets on Thursday. Christ uses all of it. He's building his kingdom. And he's using us, all of us, to do it. It all matters. It's all needed. And I believe it's all ministry. I don't know. You might be here today thinking what you have to offer God doesn't matter. You know, you might be thinking, "Man, why didn't I get one of the cool gifts? I mean, we just read that passage. There's a lot of really cool stuff in there. I don't have a lot of those gifts." You know, I was one of those people that used to sit there and think, "Man, why didn't I get one of the good ones, God? You know, that I could allow me to do great things for God. Why didn't I get one like that?" Well, for starters, we need to remember it is God who does all the great things. And yeah, he uses us to do it. But it's him who accomplishes his purposes. But here's the other thing. Have you ever received a gift, and maybe it wasn't exactly what you would have wanted? How are we kind of told to respond to that? My mother and aunt like to tell a story from my mother's bridal shower back in the day of her opening a gift and looking inside it and quite frankly having no idea what it is. And my aunt coaching going, "Just smile. Nod, look up, and say thank you." We've all gotten gifts like that, haven't we? Why are we told to respond that way? Because we don't want to offend the giver. How would you feel if you gave a gift and the recipient said, "Couldn't you have got me something better? Something I actually wanted? Thanks a lot." Well, number one, we'd go, "Well, that was rude." And we'd be pretty offended. So So here's the thing. When we reject, when we complain about our spiritual gifts, we are saying the giver of those gifts doesn't know what he's doing. And folks, that's not true. That's not true. When we reject the gift, we offend the giver. Folks, we are given our gifts for a reason. And we recognize that maybe we've been told that those gifts, and somewhere along the lines, we've put them on in a tiered system. But we all have a role to play in the Great Commission. The Great Commission is for everyone, and we all have a role to play in it. And then lastly, not only do we have a role to play in it, but we have an obligation to do it well. We have an obligation to do that role well. A few passages of Scripture, somewhat rapid fire here. John 14:15-24. If you love me, keep my commands. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. For long the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. Then Judas, not Judas Iscariot, said, But Lord, why do you intend to show yourself to us and not the world? Jesus replied, Anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. My Father will love them, and we will come to them to make our home with them. Anyone who does not love me will not obey my teaching. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. Simply put, if we claim to be followers of Christ, we need to follow his teaching. The Great Commission is part of his teaching. This isn't complex. There's no real deep theological concept to unpack here. Anyone who loves Jesus will obey his teaching. Anyone who doesn't won't. Our actions will show what it is we love. That should cause us to look inward and say, okay, am I being obedient to his teaching? Colossians 3:23-24 again. Whatever you do, work at it with all your heart, as working for the Lord, not for human masters, since you know that you will receive an inheritance from the Lord as a reward. It is the Lord Christ you are serving. Even when it seems like what we are being asked to do, it seems like it's menial or unimportant, it's not. And I know we've heard this time and time again, but you know what? It really sometimes is that simple. Yes, we are serving Christ when we do these things. And then lastly, Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Quite simply, we are made for this. We are God's handiwork.
I love that term. Handiwork, because it tells me that we aren't some byproduct of another process. We were made on purpose with care and love for a purpose. We are lovingly crafted into who we are meant to be. Friends, the Great Commission applies to all of us. It doesn't always look the same to all of us all the time, but it is not a partial commission, it is a great commission that we all need to take seriously what our role is in.
You know, you might hear this and you might think, well, okay, I get it. He's talking about whether God is calling me a pastor or a missionary. I understand that. Here's the thing. He might be. I'm not going to rule that out for you. And some of you might be ruling it out by a lot of different circumstances in your life, and I'd invite you to not do that, because God uses all sorts of skill, different skill sets, economic classes, and even age group. Just this week, I heard a story, a testimony of a missionary who was called as a first-term missionary as a grandmother because she felt that God was calling her to Africa to do exactly that, be a grandmother. And you know what? She served in an orphanage where kids needed exactly that. They needed a grandmother. They needed someone who cared and just doted on them. And what a blessing she was to those kids. So do not be so quick to dismiss the idea. But perhaps more likely, you might be calling you to be a missionary in your workplace or your school or where you live or whatever situation life finds you in. And that can mean everything from boldly declaring the gospel, but it could also be being the person who maybe doesn't make fun of the social outcast of the group, or some other way of standing out in how you love and care for the people around you that shows that you are different, because frankly, folks, sometimes we aren't that different and we should be. He might be calling you to be that, you know, pastoral presence in the life of that fellow student or co-worker or neighbor who is struggling. Friends, in pastoral ministry, sometimes people would call me like they need a pastor to go and help them. I said, do they know me? Do they have a Christian background? Do they have any background? Well, no. I said, well, would you be that person? Well, I'm not a pastor. But you have the credibility of relationship with that person, and you can stand in the gap with them. I'll walk with you. But it might be more effective if you go than me. That was a shift in thinking for some people. You know, your role right now might be to help fund some of the missions and the ministries that are going on. Your role might be a prayer ministry. That's not nothing. Please don't think that it is. Or just to, you know, to stand behind something in prayer is significant. You might be being asked to serve in a more practical way. And we, as I've said a couple times already, we devalue those things. We say they're less significant than a spiritual sense. And I invite you to not dismiss it as insignificant. I had a friend in Bible college, and he was preparing to get married, and his wife-to-be was planning to go in to be a personal support worker. That was unusual for our group, and many of you know what a personal support worker does, PSW. And we kind of was, you know, we didn't know what it was at that age, and she explained what a PSW was. And I admit, we kind of gave her a hard time and went, that's what you want to do? And she said, I'm actually looking at it as a ministry. And we kind of chuckled and went, really? And she said, yeah, because I can give people something that they don't, that it's hard for them to get at this stage. And we chuckled and said, what's that? And she said, dignity. I do it as a ministry. We stopped talking after that. Because, yeah. My mom is in long-term care, so I can personally speak to the ministry that PSWs have had in her life. And not just the work that needs to be done, but the comfort. We're blessed to have her in a Christian long-term care center, and my goodness, what a blessing that they can be in the midst of trying times. Don't for a second think that that is insignificant. And only recently am I able to speak to by experience to that. Because folks, we all have a role to play in the Great Commission. We do. We may shy away from it because it's scary. But we all have a role to play, and we have a responsibility to play that role to the best of our ability. So very simply, just a couple questions to close. How are you living out the Great Commission? It's not optional. So how are you going to live it out? What role are you playing? And are you doing that role with everything you've got as unto the Lord? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that your workmanship is so wonderful. Lord, thank you that we aren't all the same, that we aren't all eyes or ears or feet or hands, but you have crafted your body together so perfectly and so wonderfully. Lord, help us to see what it is you are doing, because, Lord, we've been trained up to think that one thing is better than the other. And Lord, it's not. That's not how you designed it to play. For the body to work, all the parts need to work. When one of the parts isn't working, the body is not functioning as it was designed. Lord, when so often we say if a body of the part, if a part of our bodies aren't working, our inclinations, we need to seek care. We need to go to the doctor. And Lord, as the great physician, we come to you and say, Lord, show us where we need to move to be the part of the body you've designed us to be. There is no invaluable, there is no non-valuable part of the body. And for that we thank you. Help us to see that value that you have put on us. Lord, we recognize that in your economy, things are different than how things are done in our society. Maybe somebody here perhaps has been told they have little value because they have not, they're not well paid for their job. And Lord, I pray that you would break that down. Because they are of value. They have tremendous worth to you. Lord, may we see that worth as well. Help us be your great commission. Help us fulfill it in this, our Jerusalem, our Judea, our Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. In your name we pray.
Trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my face will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior once more. Spirit, lead me when my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. And my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. And I will call upon your name. My eyes above the waves, emotions rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine.
God has made you to be. You would see how God has made you to be in service of Him and His great commission. And so, in the same way, I just ask, I'll leave you with this blessing from Numbers chapter 6. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn His face toward you and give you peace. Go in that peace today as you follow.